For years, there have been many women all around the world who have communicated science to the public.
Complicated science, you know, things like mycobacterium tuberculosis, the theory of general relativity, and the laws of thermodynamics.
And we are going to meet two of them. The first is a brilliant mathematician and communicator, alive about 1,650 years ago, right here in Alexandria, what used to be Egypt's capital. Let me introduce you to this historical, incredibly awesome lady, Hypatia of Alexandria! Wub wub! Let me hear you say, Hypatia!
Hypatia was one of the first known female mathematicians. She was super independent, crazy smart, and had a love for making knowledge accessible to everyone, and not just the nerdy kids in school.
But this kind of work isn't all ancient history, no. Fast forward to today, I want you to meet another amazing woman, Nalini Nadkarni.
Yep, this lady climbing this tree like it's no big deal, like it's, oh, you want me to climb this gigantic tree? Hold my drink.
And all of that in the name of science. Suffice to say, she had a lot in common with Hypatia,
including her enthusiasm for communicating science to everyone. Let's start by setting our time machine for 1,650 years ago, Alexandria. From a young age, Hypatia was a true scholar. When I was a kid, I was spending my time failing at Super Mario and Tetris. But Hypatia was learning math and sciences from her father, Theon. Nope, not that Theon. This Theon of Alexandria. Hypatia became an expert in math, astronomy, and philosophy, wrote multiple commentaries on scientific pieces, gave lectures about Plato and Aristotle. You get the picture, she was very accomplished. Hypatia was out there crushing it. She was like, I'm not gonna sit in the corner of this library that doesn't even have good Wi-Fi with this meh light and just talk to the ghost of the books. I'm gonna be like the coolest ancient science communicator in town.
But obviously she thought that she's a modern science communicator because ancient for us is modern for her. And then you get it. You get it, right?
And she was like, everyone is gonna come to my classes, leave no one behind. And everyone did, from all over the Mediterranean, from all religions. Unlike some other teachers in her time who were like, ew, you're Christian or Jewish or pagan? Don't even show your face around here. So basically, Hypatia would take the hard concepts from science books, wear a cool cloak, take a stroll in the streets, and say, oh, hello, hello, you, my friend, it's public lecture time. Do you think Plato's words are too hard to understand? Just tell me what you want to know, and we'll talk it through.
If she were a teacher today, she would be one of those that instead of, like, you know, giving a lecture and then reading from her slides all the time, be like having a discussion group and everyone would be having comments and opinions. Would be so nice. Remembering you, professor, would read from his slides all the time. I remember you.
Maybe she thought that science didn't belong to a small group of people, to the elite, or to the written words locked up in the library. It was for all, the same way stars don't belong to anyone, neither the shape of the moon, or the wonder of numbers. Maybe she saw how the sciences connected us rather than divided. And maybe that's why she was as much of a science communicator as she was a scientist. Now, being such a cool and forward-thinking woman had its own troubles. You see, Hypatia was also buddies with the Roman governor of Alexandria, Orestes. She would give him counsel and advice, probably on small stuff like, Orestes, don't wear that toga, you look like a dork. And on other, important matters of the city. Meanwhile, Orestes was dealing with some major political rivalry. One of the people from the other side tried to kill Orestes. So, Orestes was like, rude, and killed him. That got his rivals super angry, and they were like, oh, it's all Hypatia's fault, because she's poisoning his mind. So, one very sad day, they attacked Hypatia in the street and brutally murdered her. This woman who loved science and made sure others, no matter where they came from or who they were, could have access to science too.
But this desire to find creative ways to engage the public didn't die with Hypatia. It has moved through different women across different centuries, including this science communicator.
Guardian of the trees, duchess of the canopy, mistress of ecology, Nalini Nadkarni.
I'm a forest ecologist. I study trees and forests around the world. I really love sharing what I know about trees and nature with all kinds of people.
From a young age, Nalini, like Hypatia, was exploring the world around her, leading to a very endearing origin story, if I may say so myself.
When I was a kid, I used to climb trees. I'd come home from elementary school and just climb one of the 8 big maples that lined the driveway of my parents' home. And it was there that I really felt at home most of all. I felt safe, I felt protected. It was kind of my own world. There was nobody else who was climbing trees. And I remember just loving trees and loving the fact that they supported me. So I took a little oath when I was 8 or 9 years old, and I said, you know, I'm gonna spend my life as a grown-up trying to understand trees and protect them.
Nalini is the original Lorax from Dr. Seuss, like a scientist version of the Lorax. And she just saves the trees by studying them. And basically what she studies is how plants and animals that live in tree canopies affect the undisturbed forests, and how, you know, things that people do and humans do, like changing the climate or deforestations, change the forest as a whole. So like, it would be the dream team. Just like imagine, Hypatia is like wearing a cape, running around the streets, just spreading knowledge to everyone. And then Nalini is dangling from a tree and saving them and getting everyone else on board. It would be the best team. The tree lady and the math woman. Excuse me, what? I have zero talent in coming up with superhero names? Okay. The thing is, both of these women had a mission to make science more accessible to everyone.
For me, communication about science is really part of the scientific process. I mean, a lot of people say, oh, the scientific process is asking a question and testing a hypothesis and gathering data and then writing a paper or giving a talk at a scientific meeting. But I think it doesn't stop there until we actually communicate what we have been privileged to learn about the natural world.
Nalini had this experience once that really drove this point home.
I was giving a talk on a very cold January night at the synagogue, and there was one man who was clearly a homeless person. He had a bag that was full of his clothes that was sitting next to him on the pew. After I had given my sermon about the importance of trees to people of all religions and asked for comments from the congregation, he stood up and he said, "Well, I know that when I stand under a tree, I feel drier, I feel warmer. And so I think trees are like God. I feel that by walking outside of my lab, by going away from my scientific field site with my laboratory and my gear and my instrumentation and so forth, and walking into a church or walking into a prison or walking into any place where people maybe don't traditionally engage with science, but where science is as always all around them, I've been able to learn more about the values of nature."
I once heard, "You won't save what you don't love." And Nalini loves the trees. She made a promise to save them. But saving nature is a collective job. And Nalini realized, in order to get people to remember their love for the trees, she has to get out of the lab and start a conversation. Nalini's legacy is not just saving trees, though. Nalini's legacy is connection. Connecting us to nature, connecting us to the forest, to the trees, and to one another.
Similarly, Hypatia's legacy isn't just teaching math and science, or a journal named Hypatia about feminist philosophy, or a Hollywood movie, or even cool Hypatia merch. Her legacy, like Nalini's, is being a communicator, an advocate of science, sharing the wonders of the world, and making science accessible for all.